All right, good evening, everyone. Sorry we ran a little late because we had some technical difficulties. So welcome to today's first webinar series, Healthy Early Life Moments the Infant Has a Mind. So this month, we commemorate World Infant, Child and Adolescent Mental Health Day, which falls on 23rd April. So today is the first webinar, and we have three others lined up this month. So do check our Facebook page for the other details. So I'm Fiona, your host from IMH, and today we have with us APROF Helen Chen, Senior Consultant at the Psychological Medicine Department of KK Women's and Children's Hospital. So Dr. Chen, for as long as I've been here, 15 years, you've been the head. So you just stepped down, I heard. So it's been a long time for you. And how does it feel like, you know, heading the service for like 17 years?
It's been an honor, really. I've got a great team, and they are in the hands of Dr. Vic Marumutu, and he's
going to tune in. I heard that, you know, he's tuned in today. So back to this topic, Dr. Chen. So babies can't talk, right? Okay, the last time I helped my infant was 9 years ago. I mean, they're all 9 and 13 already. So they only learn to smile after a few months. So how do we tell whether they're happy or sad? Or when the baby's in the womb, does the mother's like mood or mental health affect, you know, our little one? I do have a lot of questions, but you know, I'll let the audience type their questions in the Facebook comment box, and then we will look at the questions. So for now, Dr. Chen, you can go on with your presentation.
Thanks, Fiona. Thank you for having me here. And I must thank Professor Daniel Fang too for having roped me into this series. It's always a delight for me to talk about mum and babe. And I hope all of you attending have had some dinner, especially the ones with little ones, and that your child is nicely settled for the day. So we're going to spend some time together now finding out more about your baby and how you can help to shape her amazing mind. I'm going to use him and her interchangeably, but I'll probably more likely use her because I have two daughters myself. Now, most of us think that since we can't remember a thing about our early years, it must be true that baby doesn't understand the world around her or him, or that baby can't see or hear and definitely not remember experiences. The truth is, the little guy does remember. So what happens is that very often in that pre-verbal stage, a lot of it is kept in the emotional memory, and that's probably even more powerful than verbal memory. So we remember experiences in how our body responds, and that's what we call embodied memory. Now let's wind back a little bit and look at the scientific evidence that explains all of this. Now in the early years, your baby's brain grows at an amazing pace. And that's truly what's so amazing about nature or God, creating these tiny little skulls to be pliable. You know, they only have their fontanelles fusing at about 18 months. That's the soft scalp opening that you may have noticed in your baby, and that's because your brain is growing. So some of you may have noticed that your baby's head is all sweaty and hot a short while after the baby falls asleep. So this is actually because of the amazing growth of nerve connections that seal learning experiences into memory after the baby has spent his waking moment taking all that the world has to offer into his little head, the sights, the sounds, the smells, and all. So this is really what happens in the early years. So this is a simple snapshot of how our baby's brains develop. It's ours too, this is how we started. The first part that grows is right at the bottom. It's the brainstem, which drives our heart rate, our breathing, and keeps us safe, tells us whether to run a fight or flight response. The second is what we call the emotional brain, which drives our feelings of security, of love, wanting and seeking connections. Finally, there is the thinking brain in the prefrontal area. So this is the one that teaches us to make decisions and perhaps to learn to regulate our emotions and when faced with difficult moments. Now, what happens when babies growing up in an environment that is not healthy and not nurturing. Maybe there is parental conflict or violence, poverty, alcohol, or drug abuse. The toxic stress will keep the baby in a state of fight or flight, operating from the brain stem, or freezing and operating from the emotional brain. So the baby's thinking brain, the front of the brain, the prefrontal cortex, is actually in a way deprived from the chance to develop and grow because of the lack of healthy stimulation. Now, how children respond to stress depends on how secure they feel. This is a really nice study which looked at how little children's bodies respond when they have vaccination. It's a scary time for them and they cry, right? It's painful and scary. So those with insecure relationship actually had an excessive stress response with elevated levels of cortisol, that's a stress hormone, as compared to those in secure relationships. Now, what's even more important is that we now have clear evidence that influences can actually predict your baby's brain development even before birth in the womb. Apart from the importance of good nutrition, mummy's mental health really matters. Depression during pregnancy influences fetal brain development in terms of structures and neural connections. And when mom is anxious, her child can have difficulties with focus and self-regulation. But this is the reason why we want to get the word out about talking about the real deal about motherhood. Because it's not just about pretty baby pictures and happy mothers. We need to recognize depression during pregnancy and postpartum, what we call perinatal depression. This can present with symptoms of low mood and loss of interest, with some of these other symptoms that's listed there. And when we have symptoms lasting 2 weeks or longer, that tells us that perhaps it's something that really needs attention. It's a clinical condition. There often are accompanying anxiety symptoms like feeling breathless or heart palpitations, along with excessive worries. And very often it's about my baby not growing well, is my baby feeding well, will I be a good mother? Now, the thing is, depression isn't a sign of weakness, but rather because of a combination of factors that affect our brain mood center. Just like in diabetes, we can't control sugar. In depression, our brain fails to regulate serotonin, a brain chemical that regulates our mood. So it's really important to treat maternal mental illness promptly, because mothers who are depressed often get locked into their own dark thoughts and fail to be attuned to their baby's needs. Over time, the baby looks away and no longer seeks out his mother's face, because it's actually scary looking at an unhappy or expressionless face. Infants who are in distress are hard to settle, cry excessively, or don't suckle well or sleep poorly. Other worrying signs are when baby has poor eye contact or is quiet and without energy or life, almost like a sack of potatoes. Sounds a bit awful to say that, but some of the really poorly babies who are having failure to try, they look quite lifeless, and it really is urgent to attend to them quickly. So sometimes when we hear parents say that their baby is good and does not cry, it actually can be a concern, because little beings really need to establish their sense of self and be able to express their needs. Now, as a parent, you will know your child best, just like Dr. Mary McClain has said. If your child shows lesser emotion or begins to have trouble eating or sleeping, or is more irritable than usual, it may be good to seek help and see a pediatrician to find out if there's something more that needs to be done. Now, what can we do as mothers, parents, or professionals to get it right for the little ones? Laying the foundation of strong child development is so important, as the early years determine how they will grow up in the later childhood and into adulthood. It all starts in the womb, and babies need parents who are loving and nurturing. The parent-child bond starts during pregnancy, and there are really simple steps that that can build a secure bond. The parent-child activity that I really love the best and that's easiest to do is talking to your baby. You can start by saying good morning, baby, or good night, baby. Think about how you got to know your neighbor. It really started with just greetings. And fathers too can get in on the act too. It isn't mushy, but actually really manly for dads to demonstrate that strong paternal sense. Now, when baby arrives, the first year is so important. Remembering the how they develop the neurons. It's when babies learn about how to socialize and build their sense of self-worth and confidence and regulate their emotions. They do this in the context of their families and how the people around them relate. And it's where they begin to develop positive social and emotional skills. And these actually help them build healthy relationships with others as they grow. And through that, they build resilience. Yes, in case you're wondering whether you heard me right, you did. They are learning even in the first year, not with words, because they are pre-verbal, but through relationships with caregivers. So how do they do that? With a process called empathic mirroring. When baby is happy, mommy delights and smiles. When baby is scared, mommy will soothe. And when baby's angry, mommy says, oh, what's making you so cross? So through us, baby sees a face that understands and mirrors his emotions and his feelings and makes it all okay and not confusing. Now, we often want to have these moments of reverie when we feel all in love with our babies and that all is perfect. This is good and important, but the truth is, it's not humanly possible. So there can be ruptures in your bond with baby many times a day, and that's okay, because you don't need to be perfect, just good enough. And what's really important is to have a repair. So maybe a cuddle and a kiss to make up for not being able to get to baby on time or having to go to work. You see, when mommy is perfect or too good, baby actually learns to cope with frustrations of not having their needs met all the time, which really doesn't prepare them well for life. For mummies who feel bad that you can't seem to settle your baby like the nanny can, please be kind to yourself. The confinement nanny actually has it much easier because in the first month of life, baby sleeps so much all the time almost. But they actually become more wakeful and easily overstimulated in the second month when they're learning so much and picking up so much. And that's when you're left to care for baby yourself when your husband has to go back to work. The tiredness can really bring about the tension in your muscles, which baby can pick up. So it's really important to have moments of rest and to practice kindness to yourself. So I'll teach a technique later that you can use to calm yourself down. COVID-19 really brought on a new world experience, not just for us, but for our little ones. If your baby is in infant care, where the caregivers have to be masked, it's really helpful to make sure that you have quality bedtime because they take such delight in your face. And remember how important it is for you to mirror the emotions to provide that nurturing care for the baby. So spend that time. It really goes a long way with your baby. How can you play with baby? You know, it can really be hard because you feel, I guess, a lot of us, we know our babies need stimulation and we often want to teach them and get them to learn. But sometimes it actually is not easy keeping baby engaged and actually can be quite boring. Well, here's a few tricks you can do. Your face is the best. Peekaboo never fails to delight the baby, and it can be so fun for you as mommy. And even laundry and curtains can be interesting to baby. Touch and all exploration is very necessary. So if baby wants to stick something in their mouth, that's okay. It's all right, unless it's really filthy, if you want to clean it. But it's okay and it's necessary. Please continue to talk to your baby, even as baby's out. You want to say, look at this, it's your tummy, keeps you nice and warm. As you fold laundry, we call this butteries because babies actually like that sing-song voice in a higher pitch, and it keeps them engaged in you. And it's almost when you speak in that tone, your spirits will uplift and it helps you as you care for your baby. Now, reading is highly recommended all through childhood. And if you're really not sure where to begin in it all, just let your baby lead. Because nothing that your baby is interested in is ever boring. So there's a technique called serve and return. If your baby does something, you return, and the baby gets something, you return. And that's how they grow and they build their relationship with you. Now, remember though, you don't need to keep playing with a baby, you know, keep stimulating a baby all the time. Just short periods of play in small pockets through the day is fine. And it's perfectly good for you to sit with your baby, read a book while you let your baby play with the mobile or look at the fan swirling. Just don't get the iPad because that's not good for kids. You will also want to take note when your baby needs a break, and some of the infant cues include his turning away, arching his back, rubbing his ears or his eyes, or hiccuping even, and just fussing. So when I was having my daughters, I would think, oh, they're crying, so bring them to the window, get them more stimulated, maybe they'll stop crying, they're excited. But once they get overtired, it actually is very hard to settle them, and maybe that's why they get colic. Now, with a strong bond with your baby as she grows, mommy and daddy too, you will become their secure base from which they will launch to see the world, they will connect with others, explore, they will crawl to explore or toddle out to explore, and they will want to come back to show something to you and reach out for delight. And that's when you can praise them and encourage them. And perhaps they also will feel insecure. Perhaps it's something that's threatening. They will come and want you to be their comforting person, encouraging them. When we are stressed ourselves, it's important to get help because maternal depression or anxiety and paternal conditions too can make it really difficult for us to be that secure base that they need so much for us to be. Daddies, you can help by being encouraging to mommy too and affirming her. Don't say to her, it's in your mind, you should be stronger, but tell her she's trying her best and to take it one day at a time. Whatever words work well for you. Mummies, remember that daddies can also feel stress. It's actually quite difficult thinking about providing for the family. So be appreciative and supportive towards each other. When your relationship is strong, you provide the best home for your little one to grow well. Now, you can do a lot as parents to keep well, getting into a healthy routine, taking care of your bodies and your spirit, exercise, nutrition, having some me time to relax and unwind. And I always recommend for couples to go out for a walk when you've got some help or the baby settled, and remember daddies, hold mommy's hands. You may want to write down your thoughts. It sort of helps to just get it outside of your head. Otherwise, it can really feel as if all your worries are just stuck inside. It's why you may find mummies who block may find it helpful. And of course, chatting with a friend, if you have mummies who chat with you, that can really help. And of course, reach out for help when things really get too rough. Now, in case mummies are worried about the safety of medication, sorry about that. If you've got depression or anxiety that is of moderate severity and really getting in the way of you caring well for your child, bonding with your child, then medications are indicated because we really want mummies to be well because their babies really need them at these crucial early months. So there are safe options that can be chosen during pregnancy and for breastfeeding. And definitely, therapy and counseling can be non-medication interventions that are available. And we also provide it online if it's hard to get out of the house with baby and because of COVID. Now remember, every one of us, we're a part of the village that raises all our children. So you can share what you've learned today with your family, your sister, your cousin, your colleague. And you can certainly be the support pillar for the mum and babe you know. Now, I'm going to end here with a very simple technique that I want every one of us to try together now. It works really well for mummies and daddies too. When you're feeling stressed, when baby cries, or when your little child is throwing a tantrum and you're really feeling quite wound up. Because when you are calm, you can be the soothing mirror to help your child calm down. And when you are tense, your mirror is all crumpled and baby only sees a crumpled face. So we're going to do it together. Put your hand at your heart and we're going to take three deep and slow calming breaths. There is no need to count. Just keep it deep and slow at your own pace. Thank you for doing that with me. I hope you found some calm with that call. So I'm done with my talk now. Over to you now.
Yeah, thank you very much, Dr. Chen. It seems that we have a bunch of quiet audience today. No questions other than my colleague behind the scenes. So she has a question for you. Okay, let me read out to you. Playing peekaboo, offering interesting objects for the baby to touch and explore are some of the ways to play with baby. But how do you engage? So how do you engage your infant in play?
I think the first thing is to make sure you've got the right timing. Is baby well fed? Is baby well rested? And I guess you want to put yourself in front of your baby so baby can see your face and feel that you're interested and maybe see what baby is looking at, or talk to your baby, do anything you want with baby. Sometimes I guess it depends on the age of the baby. If the baby is able to sit up, you may want to see what baby's looking at. And sometimes you may want to introduce a toy. If baby's able to sit down, it's lovely to have a safe play mat, a comfortable play mat. Just have a few toys around. You don't need to have a lot of toys. You may want to keep some toys for certain days so that every time you get out the toys to play, it's a little bit different. And I would really encourage mums to refrain from, here this is, and then trying to keep baby interested. If baby picks up something, let baby pick it up and just do whatever baby wants to be. And you may want quietly just say at the side, oh, you really like that green car, don't you? What a very lovely green car.
You're such a positive mother. I remember when my kids were babies, whenever they cried, I would take out a retro toy. And when they're still crying, and I'll be like shaking frantically, like whatever that works, you know, make sounds.
I'm a professional. I'm a professional, but you know, Fiona, that's exactly what I did too.
You know, we get so panicky, like when they cry in the middle of the night, oh, is it colic, you know? Yes. And then, you know, our parents or parents-in-law would say, you know, hey, you didn't bite, you know, chuang mu, or, you know, something like that. Then they will come in with all kinds of, like, regrowth. It's quite stressful for mothers and, like, parents.
It's actually not easy. Have
another question. Okay, how do you manage in-laws input? It's exactly what I'm saying, involvement and expectations. You know, they will come and say, no, you know, in the past, this is how we look after babies. You can't do this, you can't do that. So how do you
manage? That's a really loaded
question. Like, you know, I'm sandwiched between, like, you know, maybe our own views versus, you know, our parents' views. But, you know, yet you have to be respectful.
Fiona, I must first ask you, did you check the registration age? And are there any in-laws here? Any grandparents?
No, maybe the grandparents need to also see how to manage, you know, their own expectations that, you know, is new age now.
I have to say, you know, I completely understand that. And I don't know if there's an easy answer to this, because in-laws, they come in all shapes and sizes. And mums, we come in all shapes and sizes. Some of us are really particular and really anxious. I don't know if this helps. I think if they came from a position of love and good intentions, I'd say try a little bit to give and take a little for all, because it's everyone's anxious about building the relationship with this child, right? And if there's one thing that really helps, it's the whole village just being there for cheering your child on. That said, of course, you're the parents, and if there's something you feel really strongly about, I think it's really good to engage your spouse. The child of the grandparent is probably the best person to tell the grandparent. That said, I think that often creates tension for couples, because we often disagree with how we communicate with our...
Oh, so for example, if my baby is being looked after by my in-laws and there's something that, you know, I disagree with, then I will tell my husband, and then my husband will try to find a nice way to tell my in-laws. Is that?
Yes. And as with all things, always start with something nice. Hey, you know, thank you. I'm really glad you did this. It's so helpful. I wonder, you know, this one we learned, baby can try this. Now, I'm going to share a personal story. One of my staff, she's lovely, Incha. She's my, she's the one person who started our service together. I remember when she, I hope you don't mind, Incha, that I share the story. I remember she said that when she was weaning her child, her in-laws wanted to, was it her mother or her in-laws? I can't remember. One of the grandparents wanted to put soy sauce so that it's nicer for baby.
Oh, soy sauce.
And she wisely said, oh, well, never mind. It's okay. Won't hurt. And she was right, because in the whole scheme of things, it can't, I mean, grandparents, they start from a good position. They will love our babies. I don't know whether that helps. And I'll have to say this, children are really, really strong. Their bodies are very strong. Their minds are really strong. As long as you do, on the whole, you provide a secure environment that's loving and nutritious food, I don't think you can harm them too much.
So we don't have to worry if our parents, you know, give them, you know, occasional chocolates. Or maybe they have to do it secretly. Okay, there's a common problem. So sometimes, you know, we new age parents, we don't want to expose our children to devices, right? Like handphone or YouTube at such an early age. But when we get our parents or parents-in-law to look after our babies, you know, sometimes out of desperation, you know, they will just use their phone and like, okay, now you have it. And after a while, they get so used to it. And then when they come back to our home environment, then, you know, they kick up a fuss. So how do we like manage that? I think it's quite common, right?
It's absolutely common. I don't know if it's an easy solution. And if you think about how some families, spend their days, sometimes they're so busy and they're really, I mean, what can you do if you have got to do other things? You're looking after three grandchildren. You've got to cook and you've got to pack their clothes for the next day. It is actually a handful. I guess if you want to be able to model something for them, when you're at the house, you may want to bring them books that babies can have, little books that can be wiped clean. And you may want to show them how you can do that. That takes a lot of effort. And I guess... if you need...
Oh, is that the soft books?
Yes.
You know, so the colourful ones with the Velcro.
A stack of books at the dining table, just that will take out one at a day for each meal, you know, kind of thing. And they love lots of pictures. And when they're looking at that, you can describe it. Oh, that's the marketplace. Oh, look at that banana. Stuff like that, you know. It takes a lot of effort, though. So yes, it's not the easiest. It's not the easiest. So I'd say... be gentle with yourself. You do as much as you can. And if you can, I guess, share the load. And if daddy can help out, that would be great.
Okay. Okay. So there are also mothers who think that after 4 months, I have to go back to work and my baby is still so small. He or she hasn't really formed the bond with me, and I have to go back to work for the next like 8 hours to 10 hours every day. I feel very guilty. Like, you know, sometimes they even think should, because, I mean, mental health experts always say that the first 3 years, the foundational years, are very important, right? So therefore, as new mothers, sometimes we feel, oh, should we just, you know, take a break for like 3 years, 5 years, just to care for the baby, and then after that, we can resume.
So,
what's your take on that?
I completely understand with the struggle of so many of us moms, but I mean... well, I work too. I don't know if I could have stayed home for my kids. And, you know, the issue about working really differs for every family. Some mothers really need it because it's supporting the family. And some others might not even have the option and have to stay and don't have the choice about not working. It's really about balancing needs, I think. Remember that if you do have to work or if you want to work, don't blame yourself, because actually it's important to take care of your needs or the family's needs. They are real and important. When you are happy and fulfilled, you can be the best secure base for your baby. And maybe you can provide with a much more for your child. It is expensive in Singapore too, isn't it? When you do work, I would really encourage this now. I think moms will groan when I say this. Please sleep with your baby at night. I know it's so much easier to say, I'll let the helper care for the baby or leave my baby at my grandma's place. But I would really encourage mothers to really try having your baby sleep with you at night. Because there's something really comforting for baby to see mommy's face in the dark of the night. And much as you're tired, I don't know how you felt, Fiona. Did you remember how strong that the sense of the bond when it's just you and baby at night, the two of you against the whole world?
Yeah, sometimes. No, but sometimes I sit up and you have to pump your milk, and then you feel so sucky, and then when you look at your baby, it's all worth it. Every 2 hours.
That sucky feeling. Correct. That sucky feeling does not make you a bad mother. It makes you so much more of a good mother because you're doing it even though it's sucky.
Right.
Yeah. And these early bonds are so important, because when we bond well with our child, the children, we become able to handle them when they get to teens. It's really hard when they get to teens. They're always arguing with you and they become really stroppy. Mm-hmm. And it's the early days that you remember that keeps you going.
Right, yeah. So my 13-year-old daughter, she's starting. 13 years. Oh, we have another question. Okay, she's also on the topic of building a secure relationship. So she's asking, how do we create a secure relationship or environment with babies?
I think being present is so important. Being consistent, being calm, right? If you're if you're secure in yourself, if you're stable in yourself, your baby will feel safe with you. And I don't know. I mean, if you think about yourself as a child, what would you have wanted of your mom?
Let's have a scenario, Dr. Chen.
Yes.
So for example, the baby is crying in the cot. Do I pick the baby up immediately? Because some people will say, no, you delay, you just let the baby hear your voice. Like, oh, mommy is here, but you don't show up.
Okay, that's a really nice way of addressing it. So there are different camps to this. I like to think that in the first 3 months, when baby is really, really small, and sometimes it's actually hard for baby to cope with the hunger pangs or the emotions that rise within it. And there's a lovely book, I can't remember the title, but it's written by Daniel Stern, and it describes how babies actually experience a hunger pang like a wave, like a what's that word? Tsunami, like a tsunami.
Tsunami.
That sweeps them and they're crying out. And it's really hard for them to cope. So when the baby is between 0 to 3 months, I would say, please try to attend to baby as soon as you can. And if you can't, make sure your baby can see you or hear your voice. Now, as you get beyond that, it's actually okay to wait. Because waiting actually allows your baby to learn to be a little bit stronger and try to soothe, but you've always got to make sure that you're reassuring. So you may want to call out to baby, I'm coming, mommy's coming, just a little while. Okay, if you can't be so calm, because coming now. Something like that. Something that the baby hears your voice, and if you can't be too soothing about it, at least your normal voice.
So after 3 months,
usually,
but
yes,
the first
yes.
3 months, the moment they cry, we pick the baby up.
Of course, it doesn't mean 3 months is fixed. It's an aberration of that timing. I think the reason why I say 3 months is because if you notice, it usually is at about 3 months, roughly, that babies sleep through the night. So they get more settled.
You're quite correct? Lucky.
Most babies do, 10 to 12 months.
Around it. Mine slept through after 6 months. Yeah. But I had to carry her first, like for 1 hour, and then I slowly put her down, and then she realized, and then she would start kicking, and I'm like, okay. So yeah. I had to do that for almost a year. Yeah.
So,
and then people say that you're spoiling your baby.
Yeah, I know. But, you know, sometimes we carry our babies because we're anxious, or maybe we haven't got anyone to teach us how to do it. And it's okay. They grow up fine still. Of course, if you're able to give it a try, you may want to be near baby. And instead of carrying baby, pet baby and say in a soothing voice, it's okay, mommy's
like, yeah. You have to make all kinds of sounds, right? Like wave, yeah. You have to put water in your mouth, and then, you know, you cuckoo, that kind of sound. We do funny things. Now thinking back, it's funny. Okay, we've got two more questions from Stacey. Okay, hi, my toddler is going to start preschool. May I know how I can manage her separation anxiety when I drop her off, please? Thank you. Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Separation anxiety.
Yeah. Now, some separation protest is going to happen invariably because it's a change. And if baby does cry, your toddler does cry, it's not a failure on your part. I think you may want to hide a little and just watch her for a bit. You probably see that after a while she settled down. And the teacher will probably tell you later on that she was fine. So sometimes protesting is only just natural. You may want to prepare her for going to school, play games as if you're make-believe going to school.
Or pretend. Like,
pretend,
oh, okay.
Yeah, like go into the room, or yes, the school, okay, bye-bye, mommy, we'll see you later, and then disappear out the room, something like that before you come, before she sets off to school. I think it also helps if you find it really hard that you may have a teacher identified to be like her, the person that she will attach to. So maybe the teacher, her class teacher, or perhaps it's the teacher that's always at the door registering the kids when they come in. So one of the ways that we like to think about is you're her secure base. So she needs to go from you to the next secure base that she's got. So if you can say it, can identify that person, that would be really great. And after a while, maybe she would get to know lots of the teachers, you know. So you may want to say.
So it's to teach her that both environments are safe for you, right?
That's
whether
right.
The home environment or the school environment.
That's right. And right. You need to be in a calm state, because if your voice is.
Cannot go mountain, right?
Yes, because she is going to get scared. So you have to take that deep breath, 3 deep breaths to calm yourself, and then say, oh, hello, teacher. Teacher, what? Leah? Hi, teacher Leah. Good morning. We are here again. Bye-bye. Here, teacher Leah. Yes. And we'll see you again. Something like that. You know, whatever you're comfortable with, but you may want to make a little bit of a ritual with it when you hand your daughter over or your child over.
I remember my second daughter, when she was in preschool, she cried for almost 3 months. But I told myself I had to be heartless. Like whether you like it or not, you're still going to school, and after a while she just stopped. I think it also depends on the character. I mean, given my heartless way of doing things, she might have been traumatized. I'm not sure.
I think I'm sure you did a lot of repair when you picked her up. You asked her about her day in school. I bet you did that.
Like, how's school?
Yeah.
Like, tomorrow you're gonna cry again, but I'm still gonna leave, but it's okay.
So often talking about how wonderful school was, and what are the things, being excited with them, showing that excitement on the face can help them feel excited and happy about going to school.
Okay, so that's preschoolers, right? Okay, we have another question. Do new mothers feel like they're going through an identity crisis, like a transition into a new role, not feeling competent? Yeah, I think this is a common thought.
Yeah, becoming a mother for the first time, there is life before your child and life after your child is quite clear, isn't it? If you are a mother, that person no longer exists and you've got to find yourself. Be gentle with yourself. None of us were born knowing this. The woman who gives birth to a child and falls in love with her baby and enjoys her first year of motherhood is a rare mom. Most of us wonder, what did I get myself into? And the hardest thing about motherhood, I often say this, is you learn, and when you've learned that lesson, your baby has moved on and you've got to learn the next lesson.
Yeah, and after you think like what you've gotten yourself into, and then you go on to have the second baby, and like, what did I get myself into again?
And you may not know what to do with this baby because this baby is quite different from
the other. And they're different. Correct.
That's okay. So I think
one of the greatest pressures I faced the last time was breastfeeding. Yeah, so I only breastfed for maybe 2 to 4 months, and then like people would say, hey, you know, mother's milk, they're the best. Why do you not give your child the best? And then you can save money. Like, why do you give formula milk? You know, it's like so processed, so sweet. Yeah, so, and I know that, you know, friends, sometimes they go into like motherhood forums, and then people will say, how about you take this biscuit? How about you take this tea? Then you papaya milk and whatever, and then you try all sorts of ways, and then you still don't produce enough milk. Yeah. And then sometimes like the mothers will say, oh, you know, I just want to have my baby purely breastfed, breastfed milk, because they also hear that, oh, you know, the confinement nanny will say, oh, once they try like the formula milk, it's sweet, it's nice, they may reject your breast milk. So, you know, this kind of decisions that we have to make.
Yeah. You know, breastfeeding is a really tough thing to do. And I have to say, quite a number of the patients that we see on our unit, breastfeeding struggles really is one of the key factors about why they're getting depressed or anxious. It's wonderful if moms can breastfeed, and definitely trying it, even doing it like for yourself, 2 to 4 months. It's wonderful that you pushed on, you know, as a working mama. It's not easy. But if you can't, there are other ways you can, your child can be nurtured, and, you know, nutrition. You can definitely give good nutrition with the formula.
So mothers out there,
don't be too hard on yourself. Try as best as you can, get help, seek your lactation consultant, and find out a little bit more. Maybe there's something that you're doing differently. And of course, when your friends do give you suggestions, I know it does feel a little bit of a pressure, but maybe some of their tips can help. So give it a try. But if you realize that it's really getting too much, and you're spending, your relationship is more with the pump than it is with baby, then perhaps it's time to give up. I would really like to also say this for all of us who are also employers and colleagues. Think about what we can do in the workspace to support mums who are breastfeeding. I have to say, my boss, when I was in IMH, loaned me his office. And at lunchtime, he would disappear. He was very kind. I could use his office to pump, and I'm eternally grateful to Dr. Adrian Wang for that.
Oh, Dr. Adrian Wang. That's nice of him. So you breastfed for like how long? A year?
First one, I struggled a little bit, so I got up to 19 months. And the second one, I got up to 2+.
Oh, wow, 2+. Okay.
But girls are easier, I think.
I have 2 girls. It was not. No, it's not easy for me.
I think it's really hard breastfeeding a boy. I think it's hard.
Oh, is it?
Yes.
Maybe our mothers out there, you know, you can share with us, how is it breastfeeding boys? How is it different from breastfeeding girls? Okay, Esther, I have 3 kids under 5. The baby is 7 months old, and I often find that I have to prioritize the toddler's needs over the baby. I don't have much time with him, and I fear that this will affect him forming a secure attachment. Okay, that means giving more attention to the toddler instead of the baby.
Because the toddler is more vocal and will have temper tantrums and will voice her needs more readily than the little one. If you are able to get someone to attend to the toddler,
the elder one.
Yeah, maybe get daddy to take the toddler out for to the playground. Or, you know, if you've got some helpers, or maybe a play date. The toddler can play with the other toddlers while you tend to the baby. That would be great. It's never possible to be to attend to all our children equally all the time. So be
especially when the age gap is not very great. Like, yes, Esther's kid, 3 kids under 5. Oh my.
Yes, and I have to say, she's a trooper of a mom. Yeah, it's really, really hard. So I have to say, be gentle with yourself. you're doing the best you can. And the fact that you're attending this talk, you know, to learn and to you asking these questions, I bet you're doing the best that you can in any way possible with your child. If you can take care of your baby at bedtime, that would be really nice. Those moments are precious. And maybe your toddler can wait a little while you settle baby. Whatever it is, I've got a feeling you're doing it as best you can. So,
like sometimes toddlers, they are okay until the new baby comes, right? You notice? And then they will start acting up, they'll start screaming, shouting. And, you know, sometimes you get so angry with them because you think that, hey, you know, you want my attention. Can you try to understand that this is your baby brother? You cannot
tell. And the hardest thing about it, when we have our first child, we often think our first child is the best, the ideal, fantastic child. Our bond with them is so perfect. And then when baby comes and they become like a monster, you just wonder what happened.
No wonder we say terrible two and terrible three, but actually it's not, right?
And the hardest feeling I feel, at least I felt that way, was, what's happened to my relationship with my older child? Why am I seeing her? Why do I think she's clingy? Why do I not like her anymore? You know?
You better not say that out. That's quite traumatizing.
She knows the story. She's heard the story. Yes, but that's normal. That's what happens in families. And it's okay. It's okay. Because it evens it out in the end. We start to see that our child is, after all, human. And if we are gentle with ourselves, we can be gentle with her too, right? Because she's also got those moments. She's going to feel insecure. She's had you all the time to herself for those years before her little sibling came along. And now she's got to learn to share. So it'll be lovely to involve the older one in caregiving, maybe fetching the diaper.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Doing the wipes.
Mm-mm-mm.
That kind of thing really helps. It is age dependent though. You can be confident of leaving the older one to help you. But if it's really the older one is just a few months, just 1 year older, sometimes it can be quite hard because you don't know. Sometimes they do pinch the little one. That doesn't mean she's a bad child. She's just acting out her feelings. Yeah. So it's important to label it for her. Say, oh, you're angry because mommy's not spending enough time with you. Okay, if you're good, when I put my baby brother to sleep, I'll read to you, okay? But you've got to wait, now. So you've got to say something like that.
Nice mother. I don't remember saying such things to my kids.
In good moments, I can. But my children will tell you that's not all the time.
It's like when you see the elder one pinching the younger one, immediately your hand, like, you stop it. She's just a baby.
Yes, of course. But I think sometimes when we act with that kind of emotion, with anger, it doesn't always help. Sometimes you've got to hold back and actually be a little bit more understanding about how they are feeling inside.
Yeah. What's the age gap between your two girls?
Three and a half, about three and a half.
Right. Yeah, because some people have them like 1 year apart. And then when one is like 6 months and you try to explain the situation to like a 1.5-year-old, it's quite difficult because they don't understand, they just don't understand.
You know, I don't know if this, what we said today or said now, mm-hmm. actually works for all families and all children. I think sometimes families have to find their way. And if there's one thing I must say, when you try your best and you do give it your best shot and you find you've got difficulties, of course, get help, see the pediatrician, get help. But I often think that families with parents with good intentions that keep their children close together and build strong relationships, I think the children will grow up and they will talk about it and will laugh about it as they grow up. I don't think we need to worry too much to that, you know, we damage our children in any way, isn't it?
So how do we help infants develop resilience?
Through a secure relationship.
Very abstract.
Secure relationships. Exactly like what I said. Because when they are secure with us and they have relationships with us, they feel strong in themselves. They know who they are. They understand their feelings, you see, better because they feel secure with us. And if mommy is able to tolerate those negative emotions in their children, the angry feelings, the sad feelings, the jealous feelings, they become able to tolerate those emotions and they will relate to other people with in a healthy way. The social relationships are strong and resilience, after all, the most strongest factor determining resilience is actually social connectivity, right? Being able to socialize, to relate to others, because that makes you stronger when you have strong relationships and you're not isolated. Yeah. And of course, if you can handle your own emotions. You know, there's a really nice Pixar movie. I think it's Pixar. Have you watched Inside Out?
Inside Out with the emotions?
Yes.
The blue girl is, she's constantly depressed, right? Then there's the red.
Yes. So anger is there.
Anger's the red one.
Yeah, so I think for us Asians, we are taught not to be angry. Children cannot show anger, cannot speak up to parents. And therefore, they are not allowed to express themselves in that way. But actually, if you think about it, anger is a real emotion. And we've really got to learn to accept that in our children, help them express it in the right way.
And I think in the home environment, we must be quite conscious, because sometimes, like, you know, when we get into arguments with our spouse, yeah, and you think that the baby is not listening, or you think that the baby is like sleeping, but you know, he or she is like quietly absorbing and learning, like what you say, right?
Yes.
Yeah, it's like, here you are, like, oh, no, mommy's here, you know, I'm all gentle with you, and then suddenly I quarrel with daddy and I start banging cupboards here and there, showing anger. Yeah. I think we need to be more conscious of how
we don't need to fight everything from our children. I feel you definitely shouldn't fight in front of your children, but if you're angry, it's okay to say, hey, that's not nice. You shouldn't have said that. It's okay to voice it. Because you know what? I've seen adults who lived in families where people don't say anything bad to anyone. Everyone's calm and measured.
Oh, that is like the false reality, right?
Yes, and it's really hard when you grow up and you have all these emotions and you can't express it. And what do you do with all these feelings that are inside? And when you become a mother, those feelings get really raw with your child and you feel as if you can't deal with that. So sometimes I think it's really important that we don't shy away from our emotions. We learn to express them, but in a healthy way.
Okay, 7:55, right? We still have time. From Carissa, what are your thoughts about sleep training? Will it affect attachment? Sleep training.
Oh, that's a loaded question. I don't know if I know enough about this. I think a lot of moms turn to sleep training because they're really tired and exhausted. I think sometimes it works if it's done. I'm not sure if all methods work, but I think the ones where they really shut the door and let the baby cry, I don't know if that's good for baby, because after a while, baby learns that no one will come. Baby learns to be quiet. And I don't know if that actually is makes baby feel secure, but rather actually quite lonesome. So I would say approach it with wisdom, and you may want to see your pediatrician, because the pediatrician may actually tell you that actually your baby's sleep routine is could change this way or other, and maybe there's something else that you can do rather than just shut the door on your crying baby.
How about night feeds? Like, you know, sometimes when the baby's like 1.5 years old or 2 years old, they will still wake up in the middle of the night, like crying from bell. I remember what I did was like to tell the baby that, you know, it's dark at night, like, yeah, you just drink some water, go to sleep. That worked for me, but I think for others, you know, they have some difficulty, and like the kid would wake up in the middle of the night all the way to like 3-4 years old, like drinking from the milk bottle. Okay, we have another question from Kaleen. I feel it's more like the baby sleep training me.
Baby sleep training you.
Yeah. You're welcomed by your baby.
If there's one thing you must do when you do get up for baby, keep the room dark, dim. If you have a light, really dim it. And even a night light, you know, you may want to put a towel over it because it can be really bright. You want to basically keep the environment dark, boring, be boring to your baby. That's not the time to talk to your baby. You know, you actually
don't stimulate the baby in the middle of the night, right?
At all. And yeah, don't even say, just be really absolutely boring. Do whatever you need to. No fuss.
Just pet.
Yeah, yeah. And
to sleep.
Yeah. You know, it's a funny story. I remember as a first-time anxious mom, I would attend to my baby, make sure I set up and did everything for baby. Then one day I was so exhausted. I was just so exhausted. I couldn't do it anymore. And she was sleeping in there. In a like a little tiny space, mm-hmm. a bit next to mine. I could no longer talk to her. I could no longer do anything. And all I could just barely pet. And it just went down. And I think she really realized, mommy, it's really boring. Because after that, she fell asleep.
Go back to sleep.
Yes, she never bothered me. I mean, she realized I wasn't going to attend to her much. And from then on, it got easier.
That's a good learned behavior.
Yeah. But I don't know if it always works for all babies.
I think so. If you
have, some babies really need, they can't last through the night and they do need to have that feed. So don't be too hard on yourself, nor your baby. Just let it be. Yeah. Okay. Everyone's different.
So the mothers to be out there, or you know, mothers who are looking after infants, don't be too hard on yourself. Yeah, those who are pregnant, take care of your mental health, eat well, stay healthy. Do your spa and whatever before the baby comes. Enjoy your long night sleeps or like sleep in, because once the baby comes, you know, for the next 6 months to 1 year, yeah, you're going to be a warrior.
And daddies, okay? Take your wives out for a walk, please, with your hands.
Yeah, and don't pretend to sleep when the baby cries and thinking that it's the mother's job. Yeah, but I think fathers these days are more hands-on, right? You know, I see my friends like showering the baby, feeding, so it's not just on the mother these days, which is good. All right, so we've come to the end of our webinar. So thank you very much, Dr. Helen, for being with us here. We have the next session. The next dialogue is on 17 April, and we're talking about speaking the language of trauma in the face of adversity. So we need to understand what trauma is, the language, and then once you understand, then we can help your kids overcome the difficulties. Okay, wait, I've got a slide to share. Hold on. Okay, may I make this announcement? So this year, IMH is celebrating our 95th anniversary, and we'll be having an open house event on 20th May. So please come join us. There'll be talks, workshops, hospital tours, lots of activities, and also a car boot bazaar. Registration will be open in the next like 1 or 2 weeks. So check out our website and our Facebook page. Okay, thank you everybody. So we'll close and then good night. And see you at the open house and at our next event on 17 April. Good night. Thanks, Dr. Helen.
Thanks, Fiona.